Thank you very much for the invitation. It's a great pleasure for me to be here. Actually, it occurred to me that this is my first talk at this venue. I have been a guest of the IHS several times, but I never gave a talk at this venue. So for me, it's a new thing. Okay, so this is, I will be talking about a, let me say this before I forget it, joint project with Bing-Yong Xie. As you heard, about rigid character varieties or character groups and relation to Lubin Tate theory and phi gamma modules. And so let me, although I'm sure that all of you know very well what classical phi gamma modules are, what they are good for, nevertheless, to warm up and to set up some notation, let me remind you of rather quickly about a few things. So somehow I use geometric notation, so let B be the open unit disk over QP, and then let me write down the usual list of rings, or at least some of them. So there is OB, which are the holomorphic functions on B. Then there is O little b on B, which are the bounded holomorphic functions. And then there is RB, which are somehow the functions holomorphic, I mean, let me be vague, holomorphic near one. So the rubber ring. And then there are, so inside there we have the E dagger of B, the bounded elements in the rubber ring. And this carries a certain, carries a norm, natural norm. And then you can complete and you get Fontaine's ring E of B, so which is the norm completion of E dagger of B. So all these rings let me maybe use a generic letter A for any of them are rings of power respectively Laurent series in one variable Z with coefficients in QP, and of course certain, depending on the ring, certain conditions on these power or Laurent series. So they carry natural topologies, carrying natural topologies. And then, in addition, the multiplicative monoid, so periodic integers minus zero, acts on any A by the variable gets sent by an element A in this monoid to 1 plus C to the A minus 1. So we have this monoid action, and then the usual right, I mean, the translation is that gamma is the group of units and phi is the action of P.
Topology clear, or for example, on the bounded or
Now, in the bounded holomorphic functions, it's usually some weak topology. So this is a, but I mean, this is, I don't go into the details of this. This is not important for the following. Now, just vaguely, let me remind you, vaguely speaking, a phi gamma module is a module of some kind, some additional conditions over over A with a semilinear action of this monoid. I mean, there are additional conditions, but just as a to remind you of the basic idea. So now we let the Galois group, right, the absolute Galois group of QP, so we have this cyclotomic character, chi sig. And maybe let me denote, I think I need this notation, denote the kernel here by HQP sig. And then the theory of fields of norms, right, they allows us to construct some kind of unramified extension A tilde of A with action of the Galois group such that the A is the fixed ring under this kernel. And then we have a residual action, and the residual action is via this character, chi sig, the above monoid action. The above, I mean, of the unit group, the above CP star action. So, and maybe I also just, right, as a typical application is Fontaine's theorem. It shows what this all is good for, that the CP representations of the Galois group are the same as the etal phi gamma modules. Over the unit ball in this ring, for example, in this last ring, just by sending such a CP representation. So tensor it with the tilde version over CP and take this fixed vectors under this kernel. Okay, so now there are, I mean, as you also, I'm sure you know, I mean, I restricted here to QP as base field for a specific reason. I mean, it's certainly the case that all of this works for any finite extension L over QP. With one exception, with the exception that the monoid action can no longer be made explicit. So this is one problem. Now there is another philosophical problem. So there is somehow maybe a philosophical problem. I mean, if you think about Peary-Glendens, so let me write this from the point of view of Peary-Glendens. Because, I mean, so this variable, so the variable C stands, I mean, if you look at this representation theoretically, then the variable C stands for the unipotent radical, I should say the one-dimensional unipotent radical, so let's say the upper one, so here we have any entry in ZP in GL2QP. And the monoid action corresponds to conjugation by certain diagonal matrices. So now, but now if you go to an extension GL2 of L, right, and you look at this unipotent radical, it's no longer one-dimensional, as a Peary-Glee group has dimension degree of the field, whereas the theory here, this theory of Hyperbolic modules of these rings, is still the same kind of power series rings. They are still one-dimensional power series rings. So this is kind of a philosophical difficulty, which we should keep in mind. So now let me describe a few words about the Keesin-Wren theory. But maybe one should, I mean, this builds upon previous work by Colmes, and there is also related work by a student of from S. Foucault. So now we take a finite, we take any finite extension, let's say of degree D, I may need this number later, and let's pick a prime element. So somehow I go from behind. Yeah, this were the classical Feigenbaum module theory. Now comes the Lubin-Tate theory. So we also pick corresponding to this prime element, pick a corresponding Lubin-Tate formal group law. Which allow me, please, to just denote this by LT. It's kind of a careless notation, but nevertheless, let me just denote it by LT. And then, I mean, it's the Lubin-Tate formal group law. So, in particular, we have an homomorphism, right, from the ring OL into the endomorphism ring of this formal group law, which usually is denoted by sending A to square brackets A. I do need this notation. This is, among others, this is a power series in over the ring of integers and has no constant term. So now it's you can use, you see I said, I mean there was this exception that the, in general this theory cannot be, the monoid action cannot be made explicit anymore. Now having such a formal group law, we can do the following. So first of all, just as a notation, I use have same rings as above. But with coefficients in L. So then I decorate this notation by an index L here. And now we can do the following. I mean, using this formal group law, so now we can let act the monoid OL minus 0 simply by a lower star of the variable is this power series A applied to C. And now, of course, I mean, now I write gamma L is the units in this ring, and phi L is the action of the prime element. So we have, of course, now, correspondingly, we have notions of phi L gamma L modules. And now the Galois group, I mean correspondingly, right, now the absolute Galois group is GL of the field L. Now we have the Lubin Tate character to OL star. Right, it describes the action of the Galois group on the Tate module of this formal group law. And now I denote the kernel by HL upper LT. So it's the kernel of Lubin Tate. And then let me just say, then an analog, then for example, an analog of Fontaine's theorem holds true. So we now, of course, I mean the HQP sig is replaced by this group. So in some sense, this resolves. So this resolves, in some sense, the exception above, the fact that the monoid action was not explicit any longer. So this now it is explicit in this using this device. Okay. But of course the rings have not, the nature of the rings has not changed. So the philosophical problem remains. Okay, so now let me go to the question. So what is the representation theoretic meaning of this open unit disk? And the answer is given by Fourier theory. So let me make a list here, maybe. So we are back now I'm back now to the first, I'm back to the original situation up there over QP. So on the one hand, I have the open unit disk. Now on the other side, I consider all continuous characters from the additive group CP to, let's say, to a varying field, but for example, I mean, large field CP star. And let me mention right away, because this is becomes important later, here continuous, this is automatically the same as locally QP analytic. So expandable, the map is, the character is expandable locally in a power series with coefficients in QP. So there is the following rather simple bijection. So this is kind of, if you want, this is kind of the character group of the additive group. This means the additive group CP, so CP hat. And there's the following bijection, so an element in the little set in the open unit disk goes to the character which maps an integer x to 1 plus c to the x. So this is a bijection. And so this means that B is the rigid, this naturally, of course, is a rigid variety, the rigid character variety of the additive Lie group CP, where more precisely here, I should maybe say QP Lie group. So we are over QP. So this is one point. Now, as far as the rings are concerned, then we have the, let's say for the first ring, we have the Fourier isomorphism, which in this context is a theorem by Amis, which says that so representations theoretically forming somehow having such a Lie group, we can form the distribution algebra of the Lie group. This is the coefficients somehow, the values of the distribution. So this is the locally QP. So now one really has to say this, because for arbitrary functions, of course, continuous is different from locally analytic. So locally QP analytic distribution algebra a distribution algebra of this Lie group CP. So this is just the continuous dual of the space of locally analytic functions on the Lie group, naturally an algebra. And on the other hand, we have this OB. And they are isomorphic via the usual Fourier recipe. So if I have a distribution mu, I send it to the function, which turns out to be a power series, f mu, in a point little c is just the distribution evaluated at this character chi c, right? I mean, the character is in particular locally analytic function. That's why I mentioned this explicitly. And so I can evaluate any distribution on it. Okay. So that gives a follow-up representation theoretic interpretation for the ring. And moreover, the monoid action, so the monoid, or monoid CP minus zero, right? It does not only act on the ring, it actually acts on the character variety, acts on CP, on the character group CP hat by this one element A, uppers, now it's kind of an upper star, but this is not important, of a character is just the same character, but shifted multiplicatively by A. And this induces via the Fourier isomorphism the previous monoid action on the ring. So also the monoid action has geometric meaning. Okay, so now let's go back to an L. So again, now L over QP finite with the previous notations. And then the additive group OL, now in the ring of integers in this field, is an L Lie group, Lie group over the field L. So I think I should clean now. Okay, yeah, I suppose. Okay, and then we have the following theorem by Teitelbaum and myself. First of all, it says that now we can form again the character group OL hat, which is all locally. Now continuous doesn't work anymore. Locally L analytic characters is a rigid variety. I'm used to use the letter X for this. So X is naturally a. So let me collect some of the properties. A connected, smooth, one-dimensional, rigid group variety over L. And I mean, technically, this plays a role in some sense. Let me add and is Stein space like the open unit disk is. So this is one thing. And the second statement, point two over there, this was point one, so point two is okay as well. The Fourier isomorphism, right, same recipe. Don't have to repeat this. The Fourier isomorphism between the locally L analytic distribution algebra and now the ring of holomorphic functions on X is okay, holds true as well. So this is now a new ring here. So now let me just, for fun, tell you how we can make a corresponding list out of this ring. So first of all, right, the monoid. First, let's look at the monoid action. The monoid acts. I should say which one. The monoid O, again, OL minus zero. Right, acts by multiplication on this rigid curve. Right, exactly the same recipe as here. You just multiply, you shift the character multiplicatively. And hence on the ring. Okay, so this is still an explicit description. There is no, I mean, okay, I will maybe say a little bit more about this later. So now just more or less for fun, let me show you that we can build up an analogous list of rings. So we do have OL of X already. So now, of course, we have OL bounded. Maybe I go here. Oh. So these are the bounded holomorphic functions. Then we have the analog of the Hopper ring, which is just the union. So we consider any, in the curve X, we consider any open affinoid Y and remove it. This is still an admissible open subset in X. Take the functions and take the union over all these, I mean, removing somehow larger and larger affinoids. So that's the analog of the Hopper ring. And then the E dagger L X is the same, but you do this with the bounded functions on these complements. Oh, L. So this carries a certain, limit norm. And so one can take the norm completion getting E L of X. Okay, so that's just to, yeah, okay, and I mean, as before, the monode action, the OL minus zero action extends to these rings, and so have notions of phi L gamma modules over these rings.
You want to remove the affinoid so that X minus Y remains connected in a way?
No, I don't care. Any, actually.
It's a limit, not a union. No,
it is a union because I mean, no, actually, you see this, I mean, I wrote it down abstractly in order not to have to introduce notation, but you actually can somehow introduce an increasing sequence of very specific affinoids which contain any other one. Yeah, so now let me make one observation. Which also maybe gives you at least an initial idea how the X is, how the X arises. So if we view the OL not as an L Lie group, but as a QP Lie group, as a QP Lie group, of course the OL is just isomorphic to D copies of the Lie group ZP. Right? And so, so now if we take the character group of this here, then we get, of course, just D times the character group of ZP, which was B. So we have D times the open unit disk. And then the X is a specific analytic subvariety given by specific equations. Of this d-dimensional open poly disk, if you want. So then, of course, the functions here, OLX, I mean, maybe I should say here over L, so to be precise. So then the functions here, they are quotient of the functions on this open poly disk. So with a big kernel, but if you restrict to the bounded functions on both sides, the map, of course, restricts, this is clear, right? And now the restricted map is injective. This comes just from the fact that the characters of finite order, right, they are, on the one hand, they are locally analytic, L analytic, whatever you want. On the other hand, they are dense in the continuous functions. So that's I mean, the bounded functions have something to do with the dual of the characters of finite order, and this density is the reason that this restriction suddenly becomes injective. And this, of course, is a power series ring. In d variables. Okay, so this at least indicates that that maybe this ring allows some transport, although this is a one-dimensional curve here, allows some transport between different dimensions. I do not know anything so far about the image, what the image of this map is, unfortunately. Okay, so now I first should say at this point we have no analog of the tilde construction. I mean, there is a natural embedding of this OLX into BD-RAM, but it doesn't seem to be the, although it's kind of natural, it doesn't seem to have the good properties which one would like to have it. So I actually believe that maybe this is another thing for the theory of perfect tweed spaces to do this tilde construction in this context. But one can do something else. So for this, I have to tell you first a kind of a third part. There's a third part to this theorem of Teitelbaum and myself. But I guess I first need some notation. I think I first need some notation. So fix a generator T prime zero of T prime of the dual Tate module of the dual Tate module T prime of the Lubin Tate Frommel group law. And I mean, this T prime, you see, can be viewed as formal homomorphism, so have formal homomorphism but over CP only. For simplicity, also denoted by T0 prime, going from the Lubin Tate formal group law to the multiplicative formal group law. So I think that's the notation I need. Right, I mean, this is as an OL module, this is free of rank one, so that is meant by a generator. And then we have the following third part of the theorem, so the map kappa from the open unit disk over CP to X over CP, which sends a point Z to the following character, kappa Z of X. Is right, I apply the power series, X is in OL after all, I apply the power series X to the point Z, and then I send this to the formal multiplicative group by this formal homomorphism. So this is an isomorphism of rigid group varieties with the monoid action, with OL minus zero action. But I mean, let me stress again, over CP. So the X actually, the X is an L form of the open unit disk. And it is non, I mean, that's maybe, I write this down informally, if you want the fourth part of the theorem, it's non-trivial, it's a non-trivial if L is different from QP. So this means, so it's really, this has various consequences that this ring is not, I mean, it's not a power series ring, there's no variable. It's not even, you see, we know by Lazar, for example, that the OB is a Bessous ring. Right, every invertible ideal, every finely generated ideal is principal, every closed ideal, all these notions coincide. It's no longer the case for the OX. The OX is only a Prüferring, but which is for most purposes still nice enough. So there's still a divisor theory on this ring, but it's no longer the case that all closed ideals are principal. So we can now use this isomorphism. So let me draw a picture. So we have here OCP X, right? It's isomorphic to OCP of B. And then in here we have OL of B, and here we have OL of X. Now this here, of course, is right. These are just the convergent power series F of Z with coefficients in CP. So let me treat this kappa. So treating kappa as an identity, right? I mean, let me view it on this side because there I can write the elements down explicitly. This ring must be the fixed ring of this ring under a certain twisted Galois action. So we have that OLX is OCPB fixed by Galois under twisted, I denote this by an additional star, for the, what we call the twisted Galois action given explicitly by the, if you work out the following explicit formula. So if we have such a power series, then sigma acts twistedly, Galois automorphism sigma acts twistedly on it just by its usual action on the coefficients, Galois action on the coefficients. But then you apply tor, the character tor, I'll tell you in a moment what it is, to sigma inverse, giving you an element in OL star, and you take the corresponding power series, apply it to the variable. So you replace the variable by this power series, where tor is the character of the dual Tate module, T prime. So it's actually simply the inverse of the Lubin Tate character times the cyclotomic character. Okay. So now let me tell you the main results we have so far. So first a little bit, I mean, I will come back to this. There are basically two results, and the second one I will come back to this twisted action, but let me first mention another thing without giving too much, I mean, without even notationally giving too much details. So let me just say, first of all, key scenes construction works well. So one day is the following theorem, right? I mean, there is this construction by Kiesing. You start with a finite dimensional filtered L vector space with a linear automorphism phi. And so I just use an analog of his notation, mod x phi l gamma l un. So this is the category of finally generated projective OLX modules with, and now I have, because this is kind of technical and this cost me too much time, so let me just vaguely say, with phi L gamma L action in quotation mark in the sense of Wach modules. So it's not a literal, I mean, the gamma L acts literally, but the phi L, of course, is not a literal endomorphism of the usual Wach type conditions on this object. So this is, and there is an equivalence of categories also in this context between the two. And I mean, let me just say that this, any object here gives rise to a, by further base extension, it becomes a true phi L gamma L module over this Robert type ring RLX. So this is one, without going into any details, this is one very clean result. The reason being that it's kind of, all you need for this is in some sense geometry, and the geometry, although it's a little bit more complicated here, works quite well. So so now let's come back to this twisted action. So back to twisted action of GL. So let's consider, let M be a phi L gamma L module over the usual Robereng in the sense of Kiesin-Renn. So then you see what you can do is you can extend then we may define a twisted GL action on M, on RCP. So we base extend the coefficients to RCP B by sigma star of, let's say, F tensor M is the original twisted action on this power series tensor. And then we use our tor sigma inverse, giving us an element in OL star, which acts, of course, because this is a phi gamma model, acts on M, so times M. You easily check that they both have the same semilinearity property, so this is a well-defined action. So then there is the following proposition. So now we pass to the M index X. I just take the fixed elements under this twisted action. So this is a phi L gamma L module over R L X. That sounds good, but possibly zero. And actually it is sometimes zero. So it's always finely generated projective with the usual this action, and the action is as it should be. I mean, it's but it can be zero, and it is zero. Let me so note works backwards. I mean, replace tor by tor inverse, and then the same holds backwards, starting from x to b. So now let me make the following conjecture. Okay, I still have a few minutes. So m to mx gives an GL, yeah, GL. There is an additional, you see on the, you still have the, I mean, the monod action commutes with this Galois action. So the monod action, you still have it, but it comes from the monod action M. So this commutes with each other. Gives an equivalence of categories. Between the L analytic phi L gamma L modules over RLB and the L analytic phi L gamma modules over RLX. And L analytic means, you see, you can derive this. You can, I mean, these actions, these the gamma L actions on these modules, they are not only continuous, they are even locally QP analytic. So you can derive them to an action of the Lie algebra of gamma L, which is just the field L, acting on these L vector spaces. They are all L vector spaces, but because the action is only, the original action is only QP analytic, this L action on an L vector space nevertheless is in general only QP bilinear. And if it happens to be L bilinear, then the object is called. So if somehow the original action is even locally L analytic, then the object is called L analytic. Let me say a few words to finish. Let me say a few words about the evidence for this. So using the Tate-Senn method in families, so this is this paper by Berger and Colmes. I mean, one can show that one can descend. One can do in Tate-Senn theory, right? One can descend to the cyclotomic extension. So if I define M X cyc, I take only the fixed elements with respect to H L cyc twisted, then this is always finally generated projective, of course now over a bigger ring, R L cyc completed X of the same rank as the original M. And one even can descend it. I mean, now it's getting into technicality, so I don't write it down. So even descends in some sense to some finite extension in the cyclotomic tower. And that means that one has the Senn operator on this descended thing. And then the conjecture actually comes down. So conjecture is equivalent. I think it's equivalent. At least it's a consequence to if M is L analytic, then this Senn operator is zero. And therefore, the thing fully descends in the sense of fixed vectors. Now, for this, we have two kinds of evidence. So this is actually a statement now in abstract, if you want, in abstract Tate-Senn theory. You can make this into a statement, removing all the geometric objects here. And then, for example, this is true. You can prove it if you start with a finite dimensional OL star representation. Then, and you do this twisted thing, then you have that. If it's L analytic, then the Senn operator is zero. And then last week I was visiting Laurent Berger, and he suggested a strategy to prove this under the assumption that, under one assumption, I believe, namely that the kernel of the cyclotomic character contains the kernel of the Lubin-Tate character. Then somehow he can use his theory of locally analytic vectors in the Tate-Senn theory to approach this conjecture. Okay, thank you very much.
Are there any comments or questions?
So if this conjecture would be true, would this have some consequences for the Gerlich Langlands correspondence for 0 to L?
Probably, I don't know. I mean, that's the motivation, of course, but I can't say anything specific there.
But you still in one dimension, everything is L analytic, and you have one variable, right?
Or in this particular No, I mean, this was this observation. I mean, one has to go to the bounded, one has to do something bounded.
Yeah, I understand.
Can you say something for this conjecture in the one-dimensional case for one-dimensional modules? Is it called in this case or not?
I mean, I've not seriously thought about it, but I would think that one can show it in this for one-dimensional modules. Yeah. Let's say free one-dimensional. You see, on this there is another difference. I mean, there, this projective was not. This is not my. These are not my antiques. I mean, over OLB, every finally generated module, projective module is free, but over OLX this is no longer true. So you really have even rank one projective modules.
You said something about the properties of those rings, that one ring in OLB, the closed, I think, kind of the closed ideals are principles, and in OLK it's not. What is the statement exactly? That,
OLX is a Prüfer ring, so there the closed ideals coincide with the finally generated ideals coincide with the invertible ideals.
In OLB.
In OLX. OLB has the better property that every finally generated ideal is even principal. It's a Bessou ring.
Okay.
No more questions? Let us thank the speaker again.